It's not absolutely 100% guaranteed because the government doesn't obey the law. Okay, they just make them. So sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But the only way they will ultimately is if we practice it. If we want to reapply the American system of law, we've got to use it. We've got to dust it off. It just needs to be used. Every day, everywhere you are, everywhere you go, and with every government person you come into contact with, you've got to remind them who you are. I'm not just this, you know, schmuck here in line waiting to sign your form. I am your employer. I am the sovereign people out of which you got your job, and you are subject to the law as well as I am. And make sure you remember that, to tell them that. There is no government immunity in the constitutional republic that we will rediscover in this country. They will be held to the same standard, if not a higher standard of performance, than we are, because they are our supposed representatives, and they better well uphold the law. So the allodial title is one way to protect your land. There are other ways, of course, through trust structures and other means. If you have assets, property, multiple properties, rental properties, then an allodial title may not be satisfactory or sufficient. You may need to organize your affairs in a business trust or some other complex trust structure. Common law trusts or offshore, there's a number of options. There's at least 145 different types of trusts. But you've got to think trust, and you've got to think of having the legal protection, the same types of legal protections that the power structure has enjoyed for thousands of years, that you just are beginning to be aware of, that if you want to hold on to the little piece that you have, that you're going to have to start thinking in these terms. Otherwise, someday, the piper will be at the door, and they're going to take away what you have, and you won't have any recourse at that point. It'll be more difficult, let's put it that way. So every time the federal government has gone bankrupt, it's transferred more of the assets. In 1995, the international bankers own it all. There isn't any land in this country, there's no national parks and forests, there's no birth certificates, no corporations that are not owned lock, stock, and barrel by the international bankers. The titles, okay, are owned. They've been transferred as collateral to the international bankers, these stocks and bonds and securities and all that. So let's talk a little bit about the nature of the currency system, because this will help to clarify why it is that we're going bankrupt. And we are bankrupt. It's because of the nature of the currency itself. This is not a constitutional money. This is only paper, by the way. It's just paper. And it is created by the banks out of thin air. When you write a check and there's no money in the bank, you get a bounced check fee. When the banks write a check and there's no money in the bank, they call it a loan. That's the difference between us and the banks, okay? And so, there's roughly $7 trillion of electronic money floating around out there right now. Electronic deposit accounting ledger pieces, that's all these are. This is only for accounting purposes only. This isn't money. It's not an asset. It's a debt. It is only a convenient way of depositing or writing negotiable instruments on these electronic, fictitious paper money systems.
What's the evidence you don't think it's money?
What's that?
If you don't think it's money,
here, you can have it.
They won't give it to me, will you?
Sure, will.
A whole bunch of them?
Now you're getting greedy.
That's right. Now let's watch your greed here. It has buying power, maybe, temporarily, but it has a fluctuating buying power depending on its value, and its value is determined by the international bankers, depending on the interest rates, the velocity of the currency, the strength of the economy, the productivity of the people, its relationship to other currencies and other economies. Well, I'm trying to make a very long story short, so, and I only have a limited amount of time. Every dollar in circulation, of which there's right now 1 trillion FRNs in circulation, 1 trillion of them. There's $7 trillion in electronic money, 1 trillion in the actual currency, of which 650 billion are offshore, and there's only 350 billion FRNs in circulation within the United States of America. Divide that by the population, and you'll understand why people are constrained, why the economy is contracted, because the money supply is contracted. There isn't a lot of money supply. But more importantly than money supply is the velocity of money. That is really the key factor. It's not so much that there's only 350 billion of these, but how fast do these exchange hands? You could stimulate an economy in this room very quickly if you were all willing to offer goods and services to each other for 20 bucks. And just watch the velocity create an economic system. But as long as we are holding on to it like this, scared to let it go because it's my last one, and I've got to pay my rent and I've got to do all this stuff, economies stifle when there's no velocity. There's no velocity because there's no trust, there's no community organization, and also we don't understand the nature of it. When you understand the nature of it, that this is only a tool to create an economy, unfortunately, this tool creates an economy that transfers all the wealth from the people to the hands of a small few who pull the strings of this New World Order. And so you've got to understand the nature of money, because we are so psychologically off base with regards to it. We have a lot of addictions around it. We make a lot of decisions in our lives based on we have it or we don't. And we neglect things that we need in our lives sometimes. Something we need for our health, something that we need for our children, something we need to eat even, because we don't have these. We suffer a lot because of what we think this is. And there are alternatives. Every one of these that are in circulation incurs a debt. The federal debt isn't just what the federal government spends in excess of revenues, but every dollar in your pocket sitting there right now, idle in your pocket, is accruing a debt that can never be paid off, which is the end of a long cycle of shifting all the sovereignty and the property of the American people over to the international bankers. And we barely noticed. That's how sublime and so clever and so gradual it was. We didn't notice that it happened until recently. We just started noticing again. So every dollar in circulation, all that 1 trillion in circulation is incurring a debt right now and interest at the prime rate. Every dollar in circulation, which can never be paid off. I'll give you a few examples of a few ways that the banking system makes money. The U.S. Treasury still prints these at 3 cents apiece for a $100 bill. The Federal Reserve Bank buys it for 3 cents, then loans it back to the federal government for $100 plus interest. Pretty handsome profit, wouldn't you say? $99.97 profit on every $100 bill in circulation plus interest. Well, if I had a scam going like that, it wouldn't take very long for me to have all of your property either. Or anybody else who had a scam going like that. It wouldn't take very long until you had everything. Now, would it? That's only one way that the banks make money. The other way that they make money is through the fractional reserve banking system, which is that when you deposit a $100 bill in a bank, the bank only has to keep a certain percentage of that on reserve. It used to be 20%. Then it was 10%. And now it's like 3% right now. So, which that means if you deposit a $100 bill in the bank only has to keep $3 in the drawer in case you come back for it. The other $97, it instantly loans out at prevailing rates of interest and speculates on derivatives and speculates on real estate and buys all kinds of things. That's pretty good leverage, wouldn't you say? I think we should all create our own bank.
Yes.
I think we need to create our own bank. First, you set up a community trust structure, and then you appoint everybody as a managing director of a trust. You set up a trust account for everybody. Everybody pools all this together. You buy gold and silver with it. You invest it, and you pay dividends back to everybody in the community. That's how we could run an economic system and completely bypass the federal government and the international bankers. Every community could do that. Every church could do that. Every organization could do that. Every family could do that. And watch the wealth start shifting back into your hands again instead of into the hands of those who really don't care about your wealth. The New World Order has no concern for your money, really. They just want power and control. That's all they want. Because they're scared and insecure.